متعجبين. Praise be to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Lord of here and the hereafter. We praise him out of gratefulness for his favor and seek his assistance in fulfilling our obligation. We convey our greeting and salutation to the most noble and beloved of all prophets, Prophet Muhammad and his pure progenies. Sisters and brothers, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Ibadullah, awsikum wa iyyai bi taqwallah. Qala al-imam Zainul Abidin alayhi salatu wa salam, ya ibn Adam, إنك ميت ومبعوث وموقوف بين يدي الله عز وجل ومسؤول فأعد له جواب. O son of Adam, you will have to depart and will be resurrected. Then you have to stand for questioning by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So prepare your response now. We start with the usual reminder. Could I ask everyone to turn off their cell phone? In 2 days from now, we have the anniversary of the martyrdom of Imam Zain al-Abidin, our fourth Imam, alayhi salatu wasalam. And today happened to be the 19th anniversary of 9/11. 19 years of suffering of people in Afghanistan and 17 years of suffering in Iraq as a consequence of it. As I was preparing to come out, I received sad news. It's with deep sorrow that I have to announce the departure of one of the founding fathers of this center, Marhum Haj Naif Samhat, who passed away just this morning. I would like to ask everyone to take a minute and recite Surah Al-Fatiha for his soul and the soul of all newly departed. قبلها الصلاة على محمد وآل محمد. As I said, in 2 days from now, the anniversary is on Sunday, the anniversary of departure and the martyrdom of the fourth Imam, Imam Zain al-Abidin. For most 12 Shias, the point at which we begin to hear or at least be introduced to have some kind of an image from Imam Zain al-Abidin is on the day of Ashura. Hardly any image or any understanding of what happens before. You are suddenly catapulted as if the Imam is introduced to us on the day of Ashura. But if we, and then naturally the following of the events after Ashura, in which he and Sayyida Zainab salamullah alayha, his auntie, work together to turn the table, so to speak, on Bani Umayyah and take the message of Ahlul Bayt right to the heart of Bani Umayyah, to the Sham and the palace of Yazid. That far is good. That's not a problem with it. But if we ask ourselves, apart from this anecdotal issue of understanding, who was Imam Zain al-Abidin beyond this Karbala issue? What do we understand from him? As far as his biographical, well, it's very short. We give some brief biographical history. He was born 38 after Hijrah, literally 2 years before the martyrdom of Imam Amir al-Mu'mineen, salawatullah salamu alayhi, his grandfather. So he did not stay with him long enough, only 2 years. He stayed with Imam Hassan, salawatullah salam alayhi, and saw what happened to him, how people turned back and changed their allegiance to Imam Hassan, and how money and wealth could buy the honor and dignity of the community at that time, Muawiyah. 10 years with Imam Hassan. And the rest of his life up to Karbala when he was 24 with Imam Hussein. After that, for 35 years of Imam, that he took the responsibility of the Shia community. And during this period, the 35 years of his Imama were most pivotal and central to the Shia community. And I will briefly explain why, particularly to the construction of what we call today Al-Madhab al-Ja'fari, or the school of Ahlul Bayt. Imam focused his life on three issues. Number one, because of the distorted image of Islam within the community, Imam's first responsibility was to reintroduce Islam to the community that had lost completely touch with true Islam. They had no clue. The Islam that they were introduced and they were familiar with, Islam of Bani Umayyah and the scholars of the court, the way they decided, which not naturally they turned the whole thing around. Bani Umayyah become Ahlul Bayt, and Ahlul Bayt become Khawarij, outside the realm of Islam. Second is to reintroduce Ahlul Bayt, because 40 years of Muawiyah's public relation completely destroyed it. Reintroduce Ahlul Bayt, the values of Ahlul Bayt, the moral standard of Ahlul Bayt, the manner, the behavior of Ahlul Bayt to the Muslim community in general. And to do that, he started organizing what we call today study groups, taught in Masjid al-Nabi and other places on tafsir, fiqh, hadith, usul, and other issues. The teaching that he gave during this period became the backbone for the intellectual school that Imam Muhammad al-Baqir, Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq, focused on during their life. So when they came, they did not happen to fall into some kind of a vacuum that they had to start from scratch. Imam Zainul Abidin had already started the process. Even some of the grand scholars of Ahl Sunnah studied under Imam Zain al-Abidin and collecting hadith and everything else. Most important of all is the establishment of what we call organized Shia networking. When Imam Muhammad al-Baqir, that principle was used by the latter Imams, but the founding father of this, the person who really paid attention to the critical role of networking for the Shia community, and it becomes so critical for where we are now and as we try to organize ourselves for the coming election. Imam Zain al-Abidin saw the critical nature of it, that the Shia need to organize themselves and work in a kind of network. So what he did was, it was very difficult for him to rely on the community that had just martyred or killed his father and slaughtered the entire disciples. So he started from scratch, buying slaves, freeing them, teaching them, and then sending them around to start the nature, the whole essence of the Shia community. During his life, he saw the three uprisings. And that these three uprisings, the failure of these three uprisings, within literally 5 or 6 years of Karbala, teaches us a few lessons. Number one, a year after the incident of Karbala, it was the Waqa'at al-Harra, which were people of Medina decided that Yazid was not worthy of somebody becoming Khalifatul Muslimin, And particularly those who abstained from supporting Imam Hussein salawatullah salam alayhi in his endeavor against the Yazid and Bani Umayyah, suddenly enlightened by the reality, they decided to rise, kick the Wali, the governor of Yazid, out and revolt against Yazid. This was 63, 2 years after. Finally, the battle took place. Yazid sends the army and wipes them out. Why? Disorganized, no leadership, and dysfunctional. They are emotionally reactive rather than having a proper plan. And they were destroyed. Historians, could I ask everyone, please, Hajj, turn off your cell phone. Historians claim the outcome of Waqa'at al-Harra in Medina was at least 40,000 illegitimate children. Why? Because Yazid declared Medina an open city. You can do whatever you want. Khalifatul Muslimin, the representative of the Holy Prophet, declares Medina to Nabi an open city for the soldiers to do what they want. When the opportunity comes for us to defend justice, we, for whatever reason we stay away, the price will be paid. A few years later, Harakat al-Tawwabin in Kufa, people who realized what had happened to Ahlul Bayt, and particularly Imam Hussein, they decided again emotionally, we simply want to repent. With no structure, no leadership, they were wiped out by Ubaydullah ibn Ziyad again. Finally comes the third one, year 66 after Hijrah, Mukhtar. And although initially he succeeds in defeating Ubaydullah ibn Ziyad in northern Iraq, and then killing a number of those who participated in Karbala, but yet infighting between themselves led to weakness and Abdullah ibn Zubayr coming in, sending an army and killing Mukhtar, and that was the end of the third. Imam Zain al-Abidin did not participate in any of them. He knew when the leadership is not prepared to accept that Imam is there, and you go to him for leadership rather than organize a leadership, some kind of quasi-leadership for yourself, that's the price. And all the affairs that came after, during the life of Imam Muhammad al-Baqir, Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq, none of the imams were prepared although in principle they supported the uprising against Bani Umayyah and the tyrants, but they were not prepared to support because of the fact that there was no organization and political base within the community. We keep suffering. Let me draw a parallel with where we are now. We keep suffering as Muslim community and as Shia, minority within the minority. We keep suffering election after election. As soon as we say we have to organize, the fatwa comes out. It is haram to vote. How do you want to organize yourself? In my lecture on Tuesday, I made it clear. I ask anyone these four questions. These four questions should delineate and open up and explain the position. Can you live in the United States and become a citizen without swearing to the Constitution? And the Constitution is not Islamic. No. Can you pay taxes and refuse to pay taxes and say, we are not going to pay tax, unless you are prepared to the IRA coming in and take you to jail? Can you impose your will and say, well, I'm prepared to pay the tax, but I don't want it to be supporting Zionism or somewhere else? No. The question is, if we can't do any of them, shouldn't we do something, at least be part of the picture to influence what's going on? First, by voting. Secondly, taking this one stage further and becoming a candidate, whether it's local, regional, or national election. Why is it? I mean, no disrespect to anybody else. A Jewish person can go and put his name or her name down as a candidate, but a Muslim person cannot, or a Shia in particular shouldn't. We are equally qualified, if not more. Imam talks about organization. That's almost 1,400 years ago. We have one book left from Imam Zain al-Abidin, which is, well, at least the major one, Sahifa Sajjadiyya. Even not only in understanding the Imam, we don't have a proper picture. When it comes to this Sahifa Sajjadiyya, we don't have a true understanding of what Sahifa Sajjadiyya is and should, how it should be used. We constantly look at it as a book of dua, as if Imam Zain al-Abidin spent 35 years in a corner, either in a monastery or somewhere that he had organized for himself, just, oh Lord, send us your mercy. That's the understanding that we have. Every time we want to read a dua, whether during month of Ramadan or after month of Ramadan, during the Hajjah or anything else, open Sahifa Sajjadiyya. Marhum Shaheed Muhammad Baqir Sadr, in an introduction that he wrote for a particular publication of Sahifa Sajjadiyya, he says, this is where we miss the point. There were two major issues that really destabilized the Muslim community at the time, and we are not paying attention to it. Number one, the community was the coming into the Muslim community of alien culture, alien concepts, and that they were not familiar with. Greek philosophy came in, Chinese philosophy came in, Indian Sanskrit books were translated, etc., etc. Who was supposed to answer to these questions? It's easy for us these days, at least our youth can go to school and read Greek philosophy. Whether their professors will be, are able to teach them properly, that's a different story. But at least they can read it a little bit. Now suddenly the Muslim community, the Jahiliyyah, that had come out of Jahiliyyah within 50 years, 60 years, Aristotelian logic. Okay, what does that mean for the Jahiliyyah at that time? Needed somebody to explain. This is why Imam Zain al-Abidin kept organizing what he called study circles to teach them. But the most corrupting part of exposure to the outside was the wealth that was coming in. The society divided itself into two tortilla sections. Number one, the half within the society that became hyper-rich, and Quran says, إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ لَيَطْغَى أَنْ رَآهُ اسْتَغْنَى. When there is no need, or you become needless, you become godless. So the upper echelon of the society that were wealthy, I don't need God. I have all the wealth that I have. The lower level of the society, chasing the dragon. We call it today the American dream. 24 hours a day at the expense of your family, your children, and everything else, just running after the green piece of paper. That was why Imam put Sahifa Sajjadiyya and Dua together, to remind everyone that you are responsible, irrespective of what's your position. Ultimately, you have to stand before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and be accountable for what you have done. Yabna Adam, innaka mayyitun wa mab'uthun wa mawqufun bayna yaday Allah azza wa jal. O son of Adam, there is no exception. Kullu nafsin dha'iqatul maut. There is not a soul that would remain. Not only you will depart, you will be resurrected. You will be commanded to stand before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and answer questions. If you believe in that, then فَأَعِدَّ لَهُ جَوَابًا. Prepare your answer. And we all know, there is no calling. Israel comes whenever Israel wishes and he is commanded to come. There is no... Constantly, I mean, this is another reminder this morning. A founding father of this center, Islamic center, this morning departed. Isn't that a warning to all of us? Get yourself organized. Few months from now, let me end with this warning. Few months from now, we all start running around trying to get our taxes in order, because 4th of April, we have to submit them unless we ask for an extension. And we don't want to miss anything. Why? Because we are afraid IRS will come and go through the entire book, and then we have to be accountable. I wish we cared about the Day of Judgment half as much as we care about the 4th of April and the IRS and the tax. Otherwise, if we did that, our situation, our life would have been much better. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us the privilege of staying on the right path and guide us through the entire life that we have, inshallah. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Wal asr. Inna al-insana lafi khusr. Illa alladhina amanu wa aminu s-salihat. Wa tawassaw bil haqqi wa tawassaw bil sabr. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين نحمده ونشكره ونتوب إليه من سيئات أعمالنا ثم الصلاة والسلام على خير خلق الله حبيبه وصفيه سيدنا محمد وعلى آله الطاهرين وصحبه المنتجبين اللهم صل على محمد. أخواتي وإخواني الكرام السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته عباد الله أوصيكم وإياي بتقوى الله قال الإمام السجاد عليه الصلاة والسلام لا حسب لقرشي على ولا عربي إلا بالتواضع ولا كرم إلا بالتقوى ولا عمل إلا بالنية ولا عبادة إلا بالتفقه ألا وإن أبغض الناس إلى الله عز وجل من يقتدي بسنة إمام ولا يقتدي بأعماله. نعيش في هذه الأيام ذكرى شهادة الإمام علي بن الحسين عليه الصلاة والسلام الذي استوعب في أسلوبه الإمامي كل الخطوط التي تتصل بتأصيل الشخصية الإسلامية في حركة العقل والقلب والحياة، في الانفتاح على الله وعلى الناس، في كل خطوط المسؤولية. عاش الإمام طفولته في الأولى حتى بداية شبابه في أجواء الاهتزاز السياسي في الواقع الإسلامي آنذاك، فهو لم ينفتح في طفولته الأولى على الواقع الذي كان يعيشه جده أمير المؤمنين صلوات الله وسلامه عليه، لأنه استشهد وعمره سنتان، ولكنه تمثل في السنين العشر التي عاشه مع عمه الحسن كل ذلك الواقع الصعب الذي واجه الإمام الحسن. عاش الإمام مع أبيه الإمام الحسين واختزن كل أبيه في عقله وقلبه، وبذلك رأينا الإمام زين العابدين في كربلاء من أكثر الرجال صلابة، بالعكس من الصور اللي إحنا نشوفها بالمذاكر. وبعد كربلاء عمل الإمام زين العابدين على أن يخلد هذا الحزن لكربلاء ليكون خطاً في الزمن، وأن يحركه من أجل أن يفترس من كل هذه الأعماق التي شاركت في المجزرة وفي الجريمة بعقدة الضمير، وأن يجعل الأمة التي خذلت الإمام الحسين إضافة إلى الأمة التي حاربته تستيقظ من تلك الرقدة الشيطانية التي أحاطت بها. فجعلت قلوب قومه معه وسيوفهم عليه، وجعلت قوما يعيشون الحياد بينه وبين خصومه. وبدأ الإمام زين العابدين حركة إمامته، فعمل أن يحيط بالمشكلة الموجودة في الواقع الإسلامي من كل جوانبها. وكانت المسألة المطروحة في الساحة الإسلامية منذ بداية الحكم الأموي هي إبعاد المسلمين عن الأسس الإسلامية الفكرية الثقافية للعقيدة وللشريعة وللمفاهيم العامة للإسلام، وللمنهج في التفكير والمنهج في السلوك والمنهج في حركة المسؤولية. كانت الخطة هي تجهيل المسلمين، لأن أمثال معاوية وأمثال يزيد لا يمكن أن يسيطروا على مجتمع يملك وعي العلم وسعة المعرفة وعمق التقوى وإصالة المسؤولية وامتدادها. ولذلك بدأ الإمام زين العابدين حركته الفكرية العلمية كأوسع ما تكون الحركة، ما يبعد الفكرة التي تقول إن أسلوب زين العابدين كان أسلوب الدعاء فحسب. ولو قرأنا أدعية الإمام زين العابدين لرأينا أنها ليست مجرد أدعية ابتهالية روحية محضة، ولكنها أدعية مثقفة باعتبار أنها تشتمل على الكثير من المفاهيم الإسلامية في الواقع الداخلي للإنسان وفي الواقع الخارجي له، وفي علاقته بأقرب الناس إليه، اقرأوا رسالة الحقوق، وأبعدهم عنه، وفي نظرته إلى المال، وفي وظيفته، ونظرته إلى أهل المال ومكانتهم، ونظرته إلى الفقراء وإلى الأغنياء، ونظرته إلى قضية العدل والعلم ومخالفة الظلم. وقد أراد أن يثقف الأمة بالحقوق الشرعية التي تترتب على كل إنسان تجاه الإنسان الآخر. وكان الإمام زين العابدين قرآناً يتحرك، فكان يحدث عن العفو وكان يمارسه كأصفى وأمعق ما يكون. كان يتحدث عن عتق العبيد وتحريرهم، وكان يبذل أكثر ماله في ذلك بعد أن يربيهم تربية إسلامية. إن زيد العابدين عليه الصلاة والسلام استطاع أن يملأ المرحلة التي عاشها علماً وروحاً وثقافةً وأخلاقاً وقدوةً، بحيث كانت تجسيد للإسلام كله، حتى إنه عندما أرادنا أن نحبه وأن نحب أهل البيت قال: أحبونا في الإسلام، حب الإسلام. وبذلك نستطيع أن نقول أن الإمام استطاع أن يملأ مرحلته الثقافية والروحية والفقهية والحركية بما مهد لمرحلة الإمامين الباقر والصادق، فلم يأت الإمامين الباقر من فراغ، ولم يأت الإمام الصادق من فراغ، بل جاء وقد فرش لهما الإمام زين العابدين الأرض كلها. ونبقى مع زين العابدين ومع أهل البيت، لأنهم أهل بيت النبوة وموضع الرسالة ومختلف الملائكة ومهبط الوحي والتنزيل، ولأنهم الذين أذهب الله عنهم الرجس وطهرهم تطهيرا. فتعالوا لنعيش معهم جميعا حتى نذهب عن عقولنا الكثير من رجل الباطل، وعن قلوبنا الكثير من رجس الحقد، وعن حياتنا الكثير من رجس المعصية لله، لنعيش طهارة الإسلام في طهارتهم. نسأل الله أن يجعلنا من التابعين لمسلك أهل البيت والمتمسكين بولايتهم إن شاء الله. اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد عبدك ورسولك وأمينك وصفيك أفضل ما صليت على أحد من خلقك، وصل على أمير المؤمنين علي بن أبي طالب وصي رسول رب العالمين، وصل على الصديقة الطاهرة فاطمة الزهراء سيدة نساء العالمين، وصل على سبطي الرحمة وإمامي الهدى الحسن والحسين سيدي الشباب أهل الجنة، وصلى على أئمة المسلمين علي بن الحسين ومحمد بن علي وجعفر بن محمد وموسى بن جعفر وعلي بن موسى ومحمد بن علي وعلي بن محمد والحسن بن علي والخلف الهادي المهدي، عجل الله تعالى فرجه الشريف وجعلنا من أعوانه وأنصاره والمستشهدين بين يديه. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. والعصر، إن الإنسان لفي خسر إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر. والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. رجاء قراءة سورة الفاتحة على روح أمواتنا جميعا، لا سيما مرحوم العلامة محمد جواد شري والمرحوم حاج نايف سمحات اللي توفى اليوم الصبح. قبلها الصلاة على محمد وآل محمد.